And we end this week revisiting a topic we covered last year. After the Las Conchas fire killed tens of thousands of acres of trees in 2011, it also killed any chance for new ones to come back. Last year, we took you to the Jemez Mountains to see the impacts years after that fire. And this month, we have an update from correspondent Laura Paskus for this month's episode of Our Land.
Matthew Hurteau spends a lot of time here on the east side of the Jemez Mountains. Until pretty recently, it was a dense pine forest. That's all changed. In some places, aspens and locust trees have replaced the pines. In other places, there aren't any trees at all, just an open expanse.
The Las Conchas fire has burned over the Dome fire, and as a result, we've got nearly 100% pine mortality. There's a few live ones on this hill slope that didn't get burned up. But this is really why we're doing the project, to try and understand if society decides that we want to invest the resources to reforest this system, how can we use those resources efficiently? This used to be nearly continuous ponderosa pine forest. And what's come back is gamble oak shrubs. And so a lot of the shrubs we see are oaks that resprouted. They were also top killed by fire. And then we've also seen the establishment of New Mexico locust in its shrubby form. And there's very little in the way of regeneration of pine trees here, because there's very little live, mature pine trees to provide the seed. Additionally, once you kill off the overstory of the forest, the environment's a lot hotter and a lot drier, because you've got a lot more sunlight hitting the surface of the earth. And as a result, it creates a fairly hostile environment for a pine seedling to try and establish.
Hurteau is a professor at the University of New Mexico's biology department, and he's trying to learn which tree species can survive and where, to get a better idea of how we should spend money on post-fire planting projects. They grow some seedlings on the roof of the biology department at UNM and get others from state forestry.
They grow them to the point that they're called 1-0, or one growing season seedlings, so they're 5 or 6 inches tall.
Then he and others in his lab plant the seedlings, Douglas fir and three pine species, in different places, on north or south-facing slopes, in open areas, and sheltered beneath brush, to see which ones make it.
We're hoping to utilize that shrub cover to protect our seedlings from the additional sunlight that comes without having any tree cover. And so eventually, if we do get trees to establish here, you know, you'll see the area occupied by those shrubs contract as they compete with the mature trees for light.
Hurteau says we need to identify what works sooner rather than later. Warming will continue, and it's important to protect forests, watersheds, and downstream communities.
If you live in the Rio Grande Valley, every ounce of water you're getting from the Rio Grande comes from these landscapes. And so these forested watersheds are what provide a good chunk of the water that flows in the Rio Grande Channel. There are things that trees do by providing shade and stuff like that that help retain snowpack when it does fall. And having some canopy cover is useful for slowing down the rate of melting of snow and slowing down the rate at which that water enters the Rio Grande in the spring.
He says he doesn't have an agenda. He just wants to provide information to land managers and community members. Scientists can help policymakers, but the time to act is now.
We've got a relatively small window, given the rate at which the climate is changing, that if we want to establish trees on these landscapes, we need to take advantage of this relatively small window, and that's taking advantage of above average precipitation years. So when we've got a good snowpack, getting seedlings in the ground. Given the projections, climate projections for the Southwest, it's only going to get warmer and it's only going to get drier. And the warmer and drier it gets, the less likely we're going to be able to establish seedlings in these lower elevation areas, and lower elevation here being 7,000 feet, because it's going to get too hot and dry. But if we're able to get them in the ground now and growing, they help modify the environment around them such that trees can persist in an area for a longer period of time.
For New Mexico in Focus and Our Land, I'm Laura Paskus.